guys, welcome back. It had been a very hot day for the past few days, and the corpses went rotten quickly. Any house left knows how fast fresh meat can go bad. I know it too, that's why the first thing I did was to dismember the corpses. There was only one reason why I needed to dismember them. I had to reduce them to a portable size in order to carry them to a place where they'll never be found. When men see the words dismembered corpses, they'll probably feel disgusted because they don't cook. But housewives are used to taking the guts of the fish, and they sometimes even see living maggots. They take the maggots off of the food or even cook it with the maggots still on. The heat will kill them after all. Women don't tell men what they do in the kitchen because men wouldn't eat the food if they knew. So it didn't really bother me too much to dismember them. I was released from all my problems by killing them. Cleaning up the mess was like nothing to me because I got freedom and regained my happiness. I dismembered the corpses using carpenter's tools like I saw in a hatchet. I'm wearing a black sweatsuit I bought for today because I thought I might get stained with blood. But stains don't show on black fabric, and I can just throw it away after it's done. I brought a plastic sheet I found in the dump because I thought the blood might spread otherwise. If I did the work on this sheet, I could just burn it after I was done. In the end, dismembering the human bodies is no different from preparing food on a chopping board. I was very tired from chopping apart two adult bodies, but I didn't have a problem doing it. I cut off their arms, legs, and heads, dividing each body into six pieces. I heard before that blades can easily get ruined by fat when you cut apart a corpse, so I brought many kinds of tools. And I was right, I didn't have to go back and forth between here and my house to get another tool in the middle of work. And a long time ago, the construction manager was murdered and his body was dismembered here during the damn conflict. He was cut into six pieces in the same way. Well, I had two bodies, so there was double that though. I remember the main suspect was still on the loose, and the victim's arms hadn't been found yet. I wonder where he hid it. I like to ask him why he smiles wryly. Unlike the arms, legs, and heads, the torsos were difficult to take care of. I thought about cutting them into smaller pieces, but I decided against it because I thought it'd be troublesome to clean up the guts. I put each piece in a black trash bag and sprayed on a lot of deodorant. I wasn't sure if that would help against the smell, though. Many bugs flew around me while I was dismembering the corpses. After I finished putting all the pieces into each bag, the bugs were still flying around, but that was just because they could smell the blood. After I cleaned up everything, they were all gone. Now all I need to do is get rid of these 12 black bags. Burning them would be easiest, but I don't think I can burn them to ashes without using a cremator. The best way is to bury them somewhere. Otherwise, the torso, every piece is small enough to fit in my backpack. I could easily carry them without being noticed. I could throw them into the river running to the damn construction site, but if I did that, somebody would find them for sure. I've seen on the news several times before that a bag with a body part in it was found beside a river. Every time I heard something like that, I always thought the murderer was stupid. I thought about dumping them into the Onigafuchi swamp, but rotten meat floats. I thought about weighing the bags, but there's no guarantee they stay down. So that left me one choice, to bury them. There are many unexplored mountains at the end of the abandoned districts around Shiguchi and Takatsuto. It's probably best to bury them somewhere in the mountains. Well, it would be safe to bury them here in the garbage dump, too. It's not perfectly safe, and so I'm going to bury all these bags somewhere deep inside of the mountain in order to completely erase the two of them. My joints hurt since I've been using muscles I don't normally use. I cleaned up the mess very carefully and got into my hideout while still wearing the sweatsuit. I laid down on the mattress. I washed my hands carefully, but there's still dirt and blood under my nails. I should take a shower later and wash it completely. When I say things like disposing of corpses, sounds like I'm the greatest evil of the century. That's only true if I get caught. What I did isn't a crime as long as I don't get caught. Plus, I didn't do this because I wanted to commit a crime. I didn't do anything wrong. I did just protect my father's life and mine. People might speak ill of me, but I don't care about them. In the end, I don't think anybody can really pass judgment on my sins. Sins aren't something to pass judgment on. They're something to confess to and atone for. In other words, nobody can measure the weight of a sin other than the person who committed the crime. Do I regret what I did? Do I feel sorry? No, I don't think I did anything wrong. I truly believe there is no better way than killing them. I'm sure it's the right thing because my life had already started to change since the night I killed them. A few days earlier, I just came home after killing Tepei. My father was cleaning the room Tepei had trashed earlier. His eyes were swollen. He had been crying. Marina, where have you been? I was talking with him. Said Marina said he'll never come to our house again, so please leave us alone. Therefore, he'll never come back. I don't think he'll stay away from us that easily. We should watch out for him for a while, too. It's hard to explain to him why Tepei would never come back. I can't tell him he shouldn't worry because I killed him. I got the ice cubes in the freezer, put them in a plastic bag, and handed it to my father. Here you go, Dad. Your cheeks are swollen. You must have only noticed it just then. Oh, thank you. Don't worry about cleaning up the mess. I'll do it. I'll get the vacuum cleaner. Marina, he called out to me. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry. It's not your fault. They make their living by deceiving people. You were just one of their targets. Marina, did you know who they were? Yes, I found out recently. I didn't tell you because I thought you wouldn't believe me. I'm sorry. He looked down. When he told me about how he wanted to get remarried, I told him that they were bad people and they scammed others with badger games, but he didn't listen to me, so I was in the right saying that he wouldn't have believed me at all. She took advantage of your pain. I'm a very bad father. Then he started talking about how he met Rena as if trying to absolve his guilt. It's been a while. He was suffering the most and he needed to drink away his sorrow. At a bar he happened to go into, Rena's son was the one who came to his table. It was her job to be a good listener when her customers talked. Rena must have talked. Really must have been a great listener and offered words of comfort when he talked about the divorce. If he was emotionally stable, he could have taken it as a kindness that she was only offering at the time. But he was so desperate that he took it the wrong way. After that, the tragedy was inevitable. He wanted to believe that it was destiny and he glamorized everything about her. It would be easy to laugh at him and say that he was just dreaming. But I don't blame him because he was being weak was also part of being human. He had plenty of opportunities to grow suspicious of our questionable spending habits, but my father just read even that behavior as an attempt to cheer him up. He bought everything she asked him to, and Rena had landed her catch. He shouldn't have brought his lover to the house where his daughter lived, but he was crazy about her, and he didn't even think about it. I had forgotten that I was a father first. What was I thinking? He started crying. I held his shoulders gently. It's okay. You realize that in the end, you're my father no matter what. You're the only family I have. He couldn't stop moaning. We held each other and cried together. The next day, my father got up early in the morning. He was already cooking breakfast when I got up, and he told me, "Your father is going to get his act together from today onward." Daddy should have used salad oil before you cooked them sunny side up. Ugh, it's been a long time since I cooked. He pried off the burnt eggs on the pan with a spatula and he tried to add salad oil to it. It was too late. Doing that just made an even bigger mess. But I didn't say anything because I wanted to eat his eggs. I waited at the table quietly. He put the burnt eggs on a plate and brought them over to me. It looked like he tried to salvage them by adding cheese, but it didn't really work. It smelled good and crispy. It actually stimulated my appetite. Thick cut toast popped out of the toaster. I made coffee with extra milk and sugar because my father liked it sweet. We put everything on the table. It looked terrible, like the cooking glass of an elementary school, but to me it was precious because my father tried very hard to make it wearing the apron. Great, it smells good. I hope it tastes as good as it smells. It might be better that you do the cooking. I feel bad making you eat this. I'll take care of the cooking and you take care of getting a job. It had been a taboo to talk about work in our house. He hadn't worked since the divorce. It wasn't only because of the divorce, though. He just didn't have to work because the settlement my mother gave him was so huge. Plus, I let him be lazy because I felt guilty about the divorce. But my father cleared his wrongdoing by showing repentance to me. And I also atoned for my sin of not doing anything about my mother by doing what I did the previous night. Now we are free of sin. I'm going to try to find a job. I'm thinking about going to the employment service agency today. Yeah, that's a great idea. It's not money that he wanted. He just needed a normal lifestyle. I'm old and not very strong. I'm a bit worried if I can't find a job at all. What kind of job are you looking for? I prefer a desk job. I don't think a lot of companies would offer one to an old man like me. I can ask my friend, Michena, the daughter of a big landowner in Hinamasawa, so she might be able to find you something. No, it's okay. I'll do it myself. If I have to man up, you know. I don't remember the last time we enjoyed breakfast like this. I don't even remember the last time we had breakfast together. For the first time in a long time, the morning lit felt refreshing. I wanted to keep enjoying life like this, but unfortunately, I had to go to school. I told him that I skipped school today and that I wanted him to take me somewhere fun, but he tried to be a good father and said that I had to go to school. Well, I gotta go now. Okay, have a good day at school. He followed me to the front door. I was a bit embarrassed for some reason. He talked to me while I was tying my shoes. He followed me here not because he wanted to see me out, but because he wanted to tell me something. I've been sad ever since your mother divorced me, but I realized that I shouldn't be sad because I have you, Raina. I didn't have to feel sad at all. That's what being a family is about. Yeah, sure, right. Again, I'm not a good father because I had to learn something that's simple and important for my own daughter. I have to go now. Kichi-kun is waiting for me. Have a good day. Oh, Raina, I'm going to cook dinner tonight. I'll do the grocery shopping on the way back from the employment service agency. Look forward to it. I promise I won't feel like I just did. Okay, I'm looking forward to it. See you tonight. I left the house. My father saw me off still in the apron. It was the first step of our new life. I finally regained it. I finally regained everything we lost after we left Hinamizawa. My mother wasn't around, but I didn't feel sad because I had my father. The cries of the cicadas sounded as if they were celebrating my new life. The sunshine was bright and the wind was sending up a nice breeze. The only thing that wasn't nice was the ticking clock. I was late because I spent too much time talking with my father. Kichika might already be gone, but I don't think he'd be waiting for me that long. But he was there anyway. Hey, good morning. Good morning. Sorry, I am late. It's okay. I usually make you wait, so it's okay that I wait once in a while. We're really going to be late. We should walk fast, I think. Yeah, let's walk fast. We might have to run at the end. Nichi might already be gone. She's waiting for sure. We're friends. We never leave each other behind, right? Anyway, did something good happen this morning? Why do you ask that? Well, you look very happy for some reason. I just thought maybe something good happened to you. The good mood I was in must have been too obvious for Kichi-kun to ignore. I had not only my family, but my friends, too. I felt something warm spreading in my heart. Well, I'll tell you what happened this morning. My father made breakfast, but... Isn't that the right way to cook eggs? You use salad oil for making salads, don't you? What? I have to tell everyone you just said that. What did you say? Those rude remarks are unforgivable. Fine, bring it. If you're saying that, then you're willing to be and ready to be thrown down, aren't you? Hey, what's going on? Sotoko Kichin, why are you two playing an outside bet on our club activities that you'll be fun? Michin, what's an outside bet? What is it? An outside bet means what it says, that Sotoko and I would place a bet on each other outside the game. The one who played worse than the other has to suffer an extra punishment besides a normal one. That means I get to see one of you suffer no matter who loses today. So what do you say, Sotoko? That sounds like a wonderful idea to me. Kichi-san will take a punishment for being the lowest ranked in the game and another punishment for losing to me. Ah, how wonderful. Great, I like your spirit, Sotoko. Alright, let's play today's game with your outside bet. It's more fun to think about punishment games than think about the game itself. It sure is. I can't wait to see how Mesmo Sotoko is going to look after she takes her punishment. Keep dreaming, Kichi-san. Ouch, take that. Stop it here. Stop fighting, you two. The game hasn't even started yet. Chi-sensei opened the door and came in. Take your seats, everyone. Let's start homeroom, and then you can all go home. Everyone headed to their seats. Mi-chan. What? I'm sorry to ruin the mood, but I have to go home after school. I have things to do today. Oh, okay. Well, I'm sorry that you have to go. Are you busy with homework or something? Yep. Well, this all might start to stop you when it comes to housework. Myself. I don't do housework myself, or housekeepers do. You should help them sometimes. It'll be good training for married life. Don't worry about that. I already have the kind of skill you know to be a good wife. Michelle looks like the kind of girl who tries to stay away from chores as much as possible, but she can actually do everything. That's just who she is. She went through hard times to learn those things, but she acts like she learned them without any struggle. That's also who she is. I like that about her. What? Are you going home right now? Then you won't see Kichi-san go to the teacher's office wearing an embarrassing uniform. What a shame. It's going to be fun. Pity you have to miss it. Yeah, I'm sorry. You went home right after school for housework yesterday, too. This didn't happen? Yeah, kind of. It might take a few more days. Well, then I guess you can't join us for a while. Maybe. I guess I'll have to finish as soon as I can. Can we help out with the thing you have to do? If something like carrying out old furniture, let me know. I can help with that. Are you redecorating your house? Is old man can bring lots of help for that. Oh, I have an idea. We can make a game out of helping her with her housework. At this rate, the person who doesn't end up helping her will be the winner. Thank you, guys. I really do appreciate it. Well, it seems like there's something we can do. Their Friday announced Raina Riga's withdrawal from the front lines as of today. I order you to take a rest till you finish doing your housework and to return to the front as soon as you've regained your strength. Well, there are many games for four. Oh, can you play Mahjong Keychain? Yeah. My dad sometimes forces me to play Mahjong with him and his friends from work. Oh, of course, we are good at Mahjong as well. After they fooled around and made a lot of noise, I just like them as they always did. I looked at them and reminded myself that I always have a place to return to. I left the classroom with a smile. I was going to get Gucci on my bicycle. I had to find a place to bury the bags with the body parts. Hopefully I could finish burying all of them today before it gets dark. With that, everything would be done and over with. I don't like the back of the tiles are made of bamboo. You guys haven't marked them, have you? I wouldn't be too sure. Gucci-san, you sound traumatized by the experience you had with our card game. Well, I think there are some scratches on them. They're cheap ones, you know. You know, it's more fun when there's a moment of doubt, don't you think? Mijin, how many rares do you want to use? Six? Rika gentle and they're professional and it scared me. Oh well, I should start by checking the tiles. Playing Mahjong with my family is different from playing it as a club activity. I have to be cautious. It's possible that one tile is missing or that there's one extra of a particular tile in here. We don't do things like that. So that's interesting. I didn't think about that. Let's see. Let's put them all face up on the table and check them before we start the game. Come on. Everybody flip the tiles face up. One dragon is missing. One low pin and one low so are missing too. One low one is missing also. What's going on? There are so many missing tiles. Oh, I remember. Hold on a second. Man, I hit the palm of her hand with her fist, moved her chair aside, and stuck her finger into a gap in the floorboards. She then pulled a tile out of there. There you go, this is the dragon. I don't remember where I put the other three. Wait, Mion, why are there so many tiles hidden in the classroom? Yeah, well, you know, she must have hidden the other three tiles somewhere in the classroom and forgot where. We couldn't play Mahjong with the three tiles missing. I suggested playing another game, but Mion insisted that we had to find them. I suggested making that treasure hunt our game. As long as I can make Kichi-san suffer a punishment, I care little as to what kind of game we play, but to be honest with you, I prefer to play something more interesting than that. I agree. Plus, you're not sure they are here in the classroom, right, Mion? No, they're here. Or maybe this woman might have put them in his pockets and left them by with the washing machine. I don't remember. I recommend checking the total number of tiles after we play Mahjong with me next time. Everybody except Mion and nodded in agreement. What? You don't want to play our classroom tile hunting game? In other words, clean up the mess Mion made so she could cheat. Do it yourself. Don't use our club activities for personal reasons. Fine, fine. So what do you want to do? We can't play Mahjong now. What are we playing then? Does anybody have any ideas? Our club president, Mion, usually decides what we'll play. I couldn't just come up with something on the spot. While we're all thinking, Mion hit her palm with her fist just like she did earlier. I got an idea. If you don't want to hunt for tiles, let's do a real treasure hunt. When name comes to your mouth, I say treasure hunting. You ain't that right? You mean are we going to garbage dump at the damn construction site? I don't really go there often, but this place is large. I've heard that the place is haunted by the ghost of the man who was murdered there. His body was cut into pieces. We shouldn't go near. A ghost, I like it. That's even better. I didn't know there was a rumor like that. I do know that someone was murdered there, and the main suspect is still on the loose. He hid the arm of the victim and hasn't been found yet, right? There's a new rumor that the construction site manager, the victim of the dismemberment murder case, became a ghost, and that's he's wandering around the place to find his missing arm. Rika, you don't like ghosts. Don't tell me you're still scared of ghosts. I'm a shrine maiden. I can see them even if I don't want to. Well, you can see ghosts. If I remember right, I've heard those who can see spirits see them as naturally as they do us. That's utterly ridiculous. I've been living with Rika for a long time, but I've never seen anything like that. That's just because you can't see them, but I can. For example, when you're sleeping in your bed, I always see Nipa. Rika, why do you smile like that? What were you about to say? What do you see when I'm sleeping? Satoko, I feel sorry for you. You can pretend you're not scared of ghosts during the day, but I'm pretty sure you get scared when it gets dark. I'm going to go make a silent phone call tonight just to scare the hell out of her. Including myself, I don't think anybody really likes going there. Rina is the only one who does. If Rina finds a ghost when she's in her cute mode, she might take it home with her. That's so true. She did say, "How, I'm taking you home with me." Well, ha ha ha. It was so easy to imagine all of us laughed. Well, let's do this. Let's go treasure hunting. If you find a ghost, you win. Okay, you get a point if you find the victim's missing right arm, and you also get a point if you find anything that Rena would like. We can show what we found to Rena later, and we'll let her decide who's the winner. Oh, I can't wait to win the game and make Ichi's son take double the punishment. Hey, Satoko, are you sure you want to win? That means you're going to see a ghost. Woo! Stop it. You're getting on my nerves. I don't want to go there. I'm scared of ghosts, too. What do you mean you're scared of ghosts, too? Who else are you referring to? I'm not scared at all. Hey, Gucci-san, stop doing that. Let's go, everybody. Let's find the ghost. Woo! And it'll be over with. Everything will be over and done with. Yes, it will be over when the Higurashi cry. Okay, that's what, the halfway mark, I guess? Making her confession. There was no applause or curtain call. It was a quiet and lonely stage that Rina performed on alone. I think I'd forgotten to blink since her confession started. Everyone else seemed to be feeling the same way. Rina looked at us like she was a teacher waiting for the questions from her students. We noticed that she was imitating what Chisen said at the end of class, and we all smiled bitterly. I went to Yaguchi earlier to find a place to bury these bags. It was hard to pick a place because I wanted to make sure that nobody would ever find them. I even thought about burying them in my backyard because it might be the safest. But after I thought about it, I knew that wouldn't work. My father might start planting vegetables one day, and he might find them. So it's better that I bury them somewhere in the mountains. Plus, I don't ever want to let her near my father, even though she's dead. I felt like I did something very bad. Venus' plan was going smoothly. If I'd only hunted for the Mahjong tiles instead of insisting on doing something else, this wouldn't have happened. When I look at the other days, they all seem to be regretting their actions, too. If Mion hadn't come up with the idea to plan through garbage dump, if Satoko hadn't found the broken refrigerator, if Higurashi hadn't convinced us not to go, Rina could have had a few more days and she could have gotten rid of these trash bags. They never would have been found. then what would happen next? Nothing. Everything would remain the same. We could have kept having peaceful and happy days. Rena had been through a hard time, but she had been forcing her face into a smile for us. Then the fake smile was supposed to become a real smile one day. None of us were supposed to notice that Rena was going through a hard time. After a while, Rena was supposed to be able to forget the bitter memory of killing these two, and she was supposed to live as if nothing had happened. But now all of her effort, all of her courage had been ruined. I know killing people is a bad thing to do. I didn't want to do this, but I don't want to do it again in the future. But I believe this is the best solution. I also believe I didn't do anything wrong. I just applied my utmost efforts when God presented me with the equal opportunity to regain my happy, peaceful life, saying we should accept suffering and live in a marital, immaterial life without desires and nothing more than pet pretty words from those who have plenty. Nobody can belittle my efforts, whether they should praise me for what I did. They should celebrate for me. Rina Ryugu fought for her own fate, and she won. I don't know why I did it, but I interrupted her. I shouldn't have, but I thought I needed to tell her this, so I did. But Rina, why did you tell us? What do you mean? We're friends, aren't we? Friends are always on your side without exception, no matter what. I thought we were friends like family. If you told us about it, we could have helped you. Then you wouldn't have had to get your hands dirty. What Rina told us made me sad. I couldn't help myself from saying that to her. Rina told us straight that she did the best she could. She told us right to our faces. That's the same thing as saying that she didn't need us in order to do the best she could. Keisha, you can say that now, but wait, let me finish. I believe that friends were there to share both happiness and hardship. If you came to talk to us, I believe we could have done something different, and we could have led you to a better future. A better future? There's no better future than what I have right now. This is the best possible future. That's a lie. My shout seemed to scare her a little. I knew that Rina didn't believe that this was the best possible future. She didn't have any other choice. If she had other choices, she definitely wouldn't have chosen this one. I know you don't believe that because you're crying. What? Who's crying? Me? I'm not crying. Yes, you are. You've been crying the whole time. Haven't you noticed it? In fact, I didn't see any tears in her eyes or on her face at all, but that didn't mean she wasn't crying. Rina was crying. She was crying because she was driven into a corner. After all her hard work, she did to become happy. Her tears looked so sad. Anyone who can see those tears wasn't really thinking about her. I'm not crying. I won't cry. I did the right thing. I made the right choice. There's no reason for me to cry. That's ridiculous. I have no idea what you're talking about, Keiichi. I know what you're crying right now. Rina stopped laughing all of a sudden, and she spoke with a cold expression on her face. Okay, let's say I did what you just told me. I told you all about my father and that woman, and then what? Well, then what? Rina had never talked to me like this before. It was as if she was mocking my ignorance, and that made me shut my mouth. You don't know what happened last year. Last year? Yeah, last year. It happened in June of 1982. There was someone who had no choice but to kill a person to free himself from his misfortune. Satoko gasped. Keiichi-kun, I don't think you know much about him. About Satoshi Hojo-kun. I know that he's Satoko's older brother. He's been missing, but people say he transferred. There's a rumor that he killed his aunt for Satoko's sake. Therefore, it's been taboo to talk about Satoshi in my class. Actually, in all of Inamizawa. Satoshi-kun was under the same conditions as I was. He just wanted to have a happy and peaceful days. He just wanted to live peacefully and quietly with his sister. You've heard about what kind of person Satoko-chan's aunt was, haven't you? If what I've heard is true, this is what happened. After Satoko lost her parents, her uncle and aunt got custody of her and her brother, but they were miserable people. Her aunt was especially cruel to Satoko. Satoshi was the kind of guy who wouldn't even hurt a fly, but his aunt probably was the only one whom he didn't have a problem killing. That's how terrible a person she was. Everybody in Hinamasawa knew about the trouble the Hojo family had. Everybody knew about their aunt was hysterical and a crazy person, and that she bullied Satoshi-kun and Satoko-chan. Everybody knew everything. Everybody in our class knew it, too. Mi-chan, the future head of the three families, knew it. Riko-chan knew it, and Satoko-chan knew it, too, of course, because she was the one experiencing it. The friends you're talking about knew that Satoshi-kun was going through more than anybody in Hinamasawa. And what happened? Did anybody help Satoshi Kon? No, nobody did. Meng Chen had the most influence out of all of us, but she made up a lame excuse saying that it might create a conflict between the Sanosaki family and the villagers, and in the end, all she did was hurting him by offering her sympathy. That's not true. Yes, it is. Satoshi Kon knew it too. He knew that you were the only pretending to sympathize with them. He knew that you had no intention to help him. That's why Satoshi Kon started to hate you, Meng Chen. He said that you always told him you were his friend, but after all that, you turned out to be just another Sanosaki, just another person who bullied the Hojo family. I didn't mean to. You didn't do anything to help him. You rejected his request for help by sympathizing with them. Do you have any idea how much that hurt? Mian tried to find something to say, but failed to do so. She bit her lip instead. Rika-chan, you were the same, too. Now, Reina was pointing fingers at Rika-chan. Unlike Mian, Rika-chan looked emotionless and empty just like Reina did. Rika-chan, you don't have the kind of power in Hinamasawa that Mi-chan does, but your word carries a lot of weight with the old people who come to your shrine, don't they? There was something you could have done for him, but you didn't. Rika-chan, you did exactly the same as Mi-chan did. You just pretended to be his friend. All you did was sympathize with them and Satoko-chan. You didn't try to help them out of the trouble they were in. Can you imagine how cruel and merciless your sympathy was to them? Satoshi Kon wanted help. He wanted somebody to help him. He was at a dead end and couldn't get out of there by himself. He was sinking all the way down to his neck in a swamp, searching for help and waiting for someone to grab his hand. You're right. Mika's Chan's voice sounded mature. It was very different from how she usually sounded. I didn't know how to save them. All I could do was offer them some consolation. I'm not going to deny it, nor am I going to make excuses for my sin. I'm not trying hard enough to find a way to save them. I didn't know you knew. Rina gave her a twisted smile. That ugliness caused me to look away. And Satoko-chan, I don't know if you believe me when I say this, but you're way down with sin, too. I didn't understand why she was blaming Satoko. I tried to take her side, but I gasped in surprise when I looked at her. She looked like she was accepting the sin that Rina had mentioned. Satoko must have wanted to confess her sin before Reina pointed it out to her, and so Satoko opened her mouth first. I don't know if you'll believe me when I tell you this either, but I realized it on my own. I know what my sin is. I see. I realized on that night Nini disappeared. I wish I realized it while he was still there. I understand how you feel, that sense that it was too late for regrets, right? I feel the same way. It happened to me before, that's why I fought this time. Satoko-chan, I'm sure you can atone for your guilt in the future because you realize what you did. But that won't bring Nini back. He's not coming back. Satoko looked down sadly. Usually Satoko would say the opposite. She always said that Satoshi was coming back one day without a doubt. But now she accepted the fact that he would never return. She accepted it easily as if she knew it already because he's her brother. Do you understand now? She asked me all of a sudden. That's how they were in 1982. Satoshi couldn't talk to everybody. He thought he could help him. He told them that he needed help. He told them what he was going through. He consulted with them. He even came to me, even though I had just moved here at that time. I don't think it was embarrassing or shameful that he did that. People get desperate when they're unhappy. Satoshi Kon tried very hard, but he couldn't do anything about the situation, and he asked for help. He kept asking for help. You said that friends are always on your side no matter what, but this is what friends really are. They're actually just people you hang around with for fun. They don't help you when you need them. Friends are always like that. That's why I decided not to tell anybody when I found out that I was in the same situation as Satoshi Kon. I knew that nobody would help me and that nobody could. I didn't need sympathy. It only makes me feel worse. It's better that I at least had fun at school. In fact, I did have fun at school. I was very happy. I was able to forget about the trouble I had with that woman, even if only for a short amount of time at school. I wish Satoshi Kon would have done that too. He wouldn't have had to feel constantly hopeless, and he could have at least enjoyed his time at school. He didn't have any other choice than beating his aunt to death anyway. I didn't know how to help him at the time because I just moved here. All I could do was listen to him and try to make him feel better. But there might have been something more I could have done. I might have been lazy and thinking about what I could do. But at that time in 1982, I thought I was his friend. Ha 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 Interesting. Wow. Rena self-desert, the rest of laughter changed into grievous sobs. Her tears gradually wore away at our relationship of trust. Nobody will help me. Friends are just people whom you have fun with. You can't trust them. The more Rena cried, the clearer we heard her voice in our heart. Nina, Satoko, and Mikachan looked into the distance with sad expressions on their faces. I was the only one who could say anything back to her now. I had to tell her this, after she knew it too. Oh, and she knew it too. She just needed to hear it from someone. I raised myself to tell her something that might hurt everybody. I understand, Rena. I understand what happened in 1982. I understand that they were heartless, but Satoko told you this. They realized their sins. They regretted what they did and didn't do, so it should be different this time. They can understand your pain, and they can help you. You weren't here last year, I'm afraid you don't know what you're talking about. That's right, I wasn't here last year. I wish I were. If I was here last year, I would have fought for Satoshi. You're lying. I'm not lying. I've learned how important friends are since I moved to Hinamizawa. I'll fight for my friends. If I was here last year and knew what Satoshi's aunt did to her and Satoshi, Satoko's aunt did to her and Satoshi, I wouldn't have given Satoshi the opportunity to beat her to death. I would have done it myself. I would have done it in 1500 seconds. I wouldn't even hesitated. I would have beaten her to death with a metal bat. That's easy for you to say, but you don't know the kind of determination needed to kill another person. I don't know that, and I don't need to know that either. You know why? Because it's an obligation to help your friends. You don't understand, Kichikun. You don't know how disgusting it is to kill a person. You can never get rid of the dirt on your hands, no matter how hard you try to justify it. You're right. Killing a person in order to save your friends is such a short-sighted way of thinking. It might sound like I'm contradicting myself, but I think things aren't meant to go well when you take care of an evil matter by doing an evil deed. I'm proud of my conviction that I wouldn't hesitate to kill a person for the sake of my friends. But the peace I get by doing an evil deed won't last forever. We all know that by instinct. That's why we all despise evil things, I think. What? I have no idea what you're talking about. She didn't have to tell me that. I wasn't aware. I wasn't making any sense. But for some reason, I could easily imagine a world like that. A world in which I saved my precious friends by committing an evil act. The peace I seized by doing that evil deed didn't last long. It got worse. It ended in a way as terrible as the sin I committed. This was a memory that shouldn't exist. I don't know why, but I know for a fact that it happened. In that world of possibility. I'm sorry, I don't know what I'm talking about. For some weird reason, I couldn't prevent myself from smiling in embarrassment, even in a situation like this. But you know it too, don't you, Rena? You know that you didn't want to get your hands dirty. You're crying because you wanted us to help you, but we didn't. You didn't want to be a murderer. You're lying when you claim that it was the best choice you could have made. That's why you've been crying. That's not true. 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 You know better than anybody if it's true or not. You've been regretting this from the beginning. Even if you were able to hide the corpses without getting caught, you could never have washed the blood off your hands. How are you going to fool yourself into believing that you wanted to live the rest of your life bearing the burden of your sin? There's only one way to do that, and you have to believe that this was the only choice. That means you have to live your life denying your friends and denying that your friends are worth asking for help. Are we not worthy? Are we not worth nothing to you, Rena? Of course not. He always believed that friends exist to help each other. Your friends were immature last year. That's why they couldn't help Satoshi from his unfortunate fate. But people grow up. We don't make the same mistakes twice. We don't want to regret the same thing twice. So believe me, we're your friends. We're on your side. So what you're saying is that I was immature too, right? Yeah, I am. You were immature because you couldn't believe that your friends grew up. But I'm not going to blame you for that. We didn't notice until today that you've been going through such a hard time all alone. People can communicate their feelings by only talking to others, so there was nothing we could do. Because we didn't talk. In that sense, it's hard to say it, but we have to admit that this meant to happen. This was meant to happen today in order to make your choice the best one for real. We finally talked about our feelings. We know now that you've been distrusting your friends since last year and that everybody regretted both what they did and didn't do. So now we finally became true friends. Finally, but it's too late. We only notice our sins after it's too late. That's not necessarily true. For example, as your friend, I can understand things you've done this time. What do you mean by that? I understand that depriving people of their lives is an unforgivable crime. But I also understand that my friend Rena had no other choice but to do this. So I don't think you're filthy and I'm not scared of you. If something like this happens again, we should talk and think about what we can do together. But this already happened, and I understand that. When I say I understand, I mean I forgive you. I don't hate you for what you did. I said that to everybody this time. I said it to all my friends. I accept what Rena did. I accept that she had no choice other than to do this. And that this was her last resort after thinking it through many times. So I'm going to side with her. Okay, Chen. Of course, if she killed them for money or some other stupid reason, I'd drag her to the police. But that wasn't why Rena did this. She couldn't run away, and she thought it'd been through. She thought it through before she came to this point. If she's guilty of anything, she's only guilty for not talking to us about it beforehand. But I forgive her for that, too. I forgive her for coming to this point. Kichi. So, I beg you all, please forgive me for not noticing Rena's situation and for letting her go through it alone. My sin is that I allowed a day like today to come to pass. Kichi-san. We're the only ones who knew about these bags. If we keep it to ourselves, everything will be fine. Rena doesn't have to worry about a thing. Let's hide them somewhere like she planned. We'll cleanse ourselves with salt later, and that's it. Let's forgive each other for our sins. And then we'll gain our happy and peaceful days. This is it, right? Rena, this is your future you chose, right? This is the best possible choice, right? Ichikan. I jumped on the hood of the Bennett car Rena was sitting on, and I reached for her hands. I made it. This is the world you wanted. This is the choice you wanted to make, but this is something that you can't choose by yourself. All of us have to reach for each other's hands so that Rena can make the choice. In other words, I can't make it happen myself. I need everybody to reach for each other's hands, so Rena, you need to do it too. When all of us hold hands together, that's when you can go to the world that exists beyond the choice you made. Kichi-kun, I appreciate it, if you really mean it, but, I'm not sure if that's what everyone else wants. A little hand touched mine. It was Rika-chan. Rika-chan, Rena, you aren't filthy. You didn't give up. You seized your fate, even though you had dirty hands to do it. I have no reason not to accept you. Rika-chan's small hand was strong, and she spoke eloquently. I know how comfortable it feels to be stained by disappointment and everything in this world after getting lost in a maze of misfortune. And that's why I can understand how strong you are and how hard you fought alone without giving up. I'm proud of having you in my life. I agree with Kichi. I forgive you for your sin. So please forgive me for mine, too. Rika-chan, I'm just a little girl without any power, but I could have fought. I'll not give up on my fate. I'll fight like you did, so I ask you to accept me as your friend. Rika-chan usually acts childish, but now she was like a totally different person. She meant every word she was saying, and then another little hand reached out to hers. Satoko put her hand over mine, and Rika-chan, she didn't say anything, looking down for a while. Rika-chan urged her to speak. Rika and I lost both our parents. We never cried about it, however, because we have you, a family made of friends. I want us to continue to be a family for you. It's natural to get it all out and confess everything to your family because, well, they are your family. So I think today was a great opportunity for us. I appreciate that we had the chances to forgive each other for our sins. A family made of friends. So, Tucko, I like that. I forgive you for your sin, Rena-san. Please forgive me for mine, too. Ebe-chan reached out for ours. It was Mion's. I always thought it was my job as a leader of this club to talk about the importance of friends. So I guess I'm not that good a leader after all, huh? Mion. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to make fun of you. Mion still smiled and scratched her head. Rena, I'm ashamed of myself as your friend and as the club president for not being able to notice what you've been through. I'd like you to forgive me for that. Of course, I'd also forgive you for not telling us about it. You couldn't tell me because I wasn't good enough for you. I thought I was trying to be a good leader for you, but I guess I wasn't doing my job. It's my fault, so I forgive you for your sin, Rena. Rena, now you have all of our hands. We're all ready for you. It's your turn. Reach out for us. Come to us. This is the world you wanted. You have all of our hands right here for you to reach. So don't hesitate. I am a murderer. I'll get you guys into trouble. Rena, we are... Rika-chan, you don't need to say anything. We're all reaching for your hand. What else do we need to say or prove? Rena, you don't need to say anything. All you need to do is reach out for us. Come on, Rena. This is real. It's not too late. You still have choices you can make, so choose. You Just don't make it. Come on. It's not too late to start over again. When I reached out slowly and our hand touched ours, she didn't hold our hands. All she needed to do was touch our hands to show us her will. Rena chose to live to share her life with her friends rather than to refuse him for the rest of her life. I took a step closer to her and firmly grabbed her wrist. It was getting dark and some stars had appeared in the sky. We all forgave each other for our sins for the first time. And it's a little embarrassing, but Rena's tears made us all cry and we just kept crying together. We stood in a circle, holding each other by the shoulder and putting our heads together in the middle. We are a family made of friends, we forgive each other, and we are happy together. That's a memory in the back of my mind, but it's not supposed to exist. I tried to save one of my friends in that world, and the other to do that, I rejected all of my other friends. I acted recklessly alone, and I brought about the end of the world. The situation we had here is the same as the incident in that faraway world, in the sense that people have been deprived of their lives in order to save one friend of mine. But other than that, it was different. We have Reina, Mion, Sotoko, Rika-chan, and myself. Nobody was missing. We were going to regain them. We were going to regain those happy and peaceful days. The road going there might be a little rough, but we'll walk it together. We all will. We went to the place at the mountains of Yaguchi that Rena had picked for burying the bags. Carrying corpses is a scary thing to do, but it made us united more strongly because of that. Since each of the corpses is a separate plastic trash bag, we can all tell what's inside each bag by touching it. But first, we forced ourselves to laugh whenever we had to touch the bodies because we were scared, but after a while, we got used to it, to the point where we could make jokes about it. Of course, all of that was probably a bluff, but we all tried our best. Mion somehow detailed knowledge of how to hide corpses, and she told me to dig the hole deeper. Rika-chan helped carry the bags. Sotoko used her talent of setting traps perfectly to camouflage the place where we buried the bags. Me? I was in charge of digging the hole. Rina dug it earlier, but I made it a little bit deeper. After we finished all that, we walked back to the place where we parked our bicycles, and we looked back at the place where we buried the bags. It's completely unnoticeable. We'd never be able to find the place again once we left for home. That's how perfect it looked. Great. Thank you all for your hard work. We're done here. It's time to go home. Mion said it cheerfully as we just finished club activity or something. We had no more bags to carry, and we no longer had any burden to carry either. We got on our bicycles, but Rena was still standing there looking into the distance. Hey, Rena. What? I'm sorry. I think I caught a cold or something. I feel feverish and dizzy. Rena's face looked slightly red. Mion touched Rena's forehead. It was actually a little warm. She had a tough day today. She had to go through so many things. She had to find a place to hide the corpses, but she had to dig a hole. We caught her with the bags. We talked about our feelings, and we forgave each other. She must be exhausted after a day like that. Rena, you should rest well when you get home. Yes, thank you. I will. Rena, we forgive each other for everything, so don't blame yourself anymore, okay? Ha ha ha, you worry about me. What do you mean? I couldn't fool myself. No matter how hard I tried to justify what I did, I was still scared. Look at me, I'm still shaky, even with all the help I got from you. If you hadn't found me with the corpses, if I'd taken care of this alone, I wouldn't have been able to bear the burden. I'm pretty sure I would have been crushed by the pressure. She said all this with a bitter smile. It might take her a long time to heal from the pain, but it must be 100 times shorter than the time it would have taken if she did this all alone. Rena's home was the closest from here. Rena went her way, and the four of us were left behind. Mion made a suggestion. I think we should just forget about today. What do you think? I agree. I think what would be best for Rena's son, too. Rena's a strong girl. If we act like nothing happened, she'll just act that way, too. If you keep acting for long enough, it becomes real, right? We'll be able to forget by not talking about it. Our goal is to forget about it completely. I think we'll keep wondering whether or not the day of the reckoning will come for the rest of our lives. You're probably correct. It's not going to be so easy to simply let it go. And if I can't forget about it for the rest of my life, that's fine by me. The most important thing to do is to keep it in my heart forever. The most important thing is that we don't make her think about it. We nodded in agreement just as my house came into view. Well, this is goodbye. See you at school, just like always. Just like always. I will set a perfect job for you, just like always. Goodbye, Kei Chan. After I parted with him, I still felt hot and dizzy. It felt really weird. I was even staggering to the front door. It felt as if I was floating in the air, just like some very strong cold medicine. Like I took some cold strong medicine. Today, something very shocking, something that made me super happy and embarrassing happened to me. I felt as if my heart and mind were about to explode because they were filled to the brim with both happiness and sadness. I don't know whether I made a crucial mistake today or if I had the happiest day of my life. I don't know which it is, and all I could do was stare blankly into space. I felt frustrated too, even though they were my friends, I was caught in the act of abandoning the corpses. But at the same time, I felt relieved that my reliable friends accepted what I did. Those emotions were all mixed up in my heart, and they were equally strong, making it difficult for me to decide what I was feeling. I was losing my sense of balance. It was like the world was warping around me. I heard sounds as if I was in a shower. Everything left me with a feeling of unreality. When those emotions were about to make me lose control, I felt a heat on my wrist. The part where Kishi-kun grabbed me earlier started throbbing. My feelings weren't cooperating with me, but the heat on my wrist calmed them down for me. I don't know what to express. When I felt my friends, I held shoulders together in a circle earlier, but the feeling was the only thing I knew to be real. I'm home, huh? As soon as I opened the front door, I smelled it. It smelled really good. My father isn't good at cooking, but he likes trying to cook creative dishes. I remembered he used to cook something very challenging whenever he was in a good mood. So the smell was a scent that he felt that way. That's why I always liked this smell. The reason he's in a good mood is because he found a job. And not just any job, he found a job with a company created by friends from his old workplace. They remembered my father and promised to hire him. He told me that some of his other colleagues in the old company are also working there. He must be very encouraging for him to work with people he knows because he hasn't worked for a long time. The dinner looked great in contrast to how it tasted. It was dinner to celebrate his new life, to show his determination to regain his bond with his daughter and to make a clean start. I talked about a lot of things with my father that night. It had been a long time since the last time I talked with him like this. I don't remember when it was, but it reminded me of the days I was still happy, which meant that I'd finally be able to return to that time. My father still believes that Tip Eye is coming back one day, so he's still very cautious about locking the doors and windows, and he gets scared every time someone rings the doorbell. I told him many times that they'd never come back, but I couldn't convince him because I couldn't tell him the reason why they won't. He'll eventually realize that he's free. I'm sure that it won't take too long. My heart was full of many, many emotions that day. If emotions could actually burst a heart open, it might happen to me. My brain must have been overworked because so many things happened at once. My head was still fuzzy, but I managed to crawl into bed. I felt like the ground was moving. Totally lost my sense of reality. I remember that I once felt like this when I got the flu. I might get a high fever tomorrow, but I don't care. I don't care if I get sick tomorrow. I just wanted to enjoy the fact that I took a step towards the future of my decision. Kishi-kun told me something like that today. The high fever and dizziness made me feel frustrated for some reason. But whenever I felt frustrated, I felt the heat on my wrist too. I grabbed the wrist with my left hand tightly. It made the frustration go away and brought me relief. Even the dizziness I didn't like just before it made me feel like I was down in a downfilled futon. I was falling asleep in that downfilled futon on my first night in a new world. The dizziness didn't go away for a few days, but I gradually got used to it. This new world looks like the world I used to live in before, but the sunshine was a little bit brighter, and Kichi's kind of smile looked a little bit more gentle than before. We made more noise than we used to. We spit every day slowly, but in high spirits. Oh, what an idiot I am. I underestimated that dizziness, and I caught the summer cold in June. I wanted to get better as soon as possible. I should have taken a day off from club activities, but I forced myself to play with them every day, and that made it hard for me to get better. I finally learned myself my lesson recently. I don't need to feel frustrated. There's no limit to happiness in this world. As long as I keep wishing for it, it'll continue forever. I don't need to feel frustrated anymore because tomorrow I will have the happiness I have today. We'll have the Watanagashi Festival next Sunday. Michi-chan tells us that we'll have a lot of fun and that we'll go extra crazy. I really can't wait. Ooh. forestry service. Ooh. Alright, let's find out what it is. It's still June, yet the air is filled with the cries of the cicadas. How is everyone in Hinamizawa doing? The Watanagashi Festival is coming just around the corner. We staff members from the Forestry Service are going to perform a wood sculpting demonstration at the festival. We'll be happy to lend out our tools and teach your kids how to sculpt wood themselves. It'll be an excellent memorial gift. Also, we would like to inform everyone that we're going to cut down trees in the local hills this summer as part of the number XX Forest Landscape Management Project. This project involves preserving the beauty of the forest by cutting down old trees and planting new ones. The Forestry Service needs volunteers who are interested in helping us cut down the old trees. You can enjoy the beauty of nature under the blue sky while helping out the preservation of the activity. The project will begin during the summer break, so you can bring your kids too. This will be a good opportunity for your kids to learn about nature and have a valuable experience. The locations of the project are the forest and the Takasuto and Yaguchi areas. Yep, that doesn't sound too good. Anyways, guys, thank you guys for watching. See you guys next time.